Kính chào Hội Thánh. Người Việt chúng ta có câu nói rằng chị ngã em
Vietnamese
nâng. Nhưng mà hôm nay thì chúng ta sẽ học về đề tài là em ngã em nâng qua cuộc đời của Abraham.
So we lift up the father.
Sáng nay chúng ta sẽ học
story of Abraham.
And this morning we will study the word of God in
Genesis chapter 14 verse 1 to 16. Let us read the word of God.
Các vua Sodom,
then the king of Sodom, the king of Gomorrah, the king of Admah, the king of Zebulun, and the king of Bela, that is Zoar, went out and they joined battle in the valley of Siddim with Chedorlaomer, king of Elam, Tidal, king of Golim, Amraphel, king of Shinar, and Arioch, king of Eleazar. Four kings against five. Now the valley of Siddim was full of bitumen pits, and as the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah fled, some fell into them, and the rest fled to the hill country. So the enemy took all the possessions of Sodom and Gomorrah and all their provisions and went their way. They also took Lot, the son of Abram's brother, who was dwelling in Sodom, and his possessions, and went their way.
Có một người thoát được đến báo
then
cho
one who
Abraham,
had escaped came and told Abraham the Hebrews,
Abraham
who was living by the oaks of Mamre, the Amorite,
người Amorite anh của
brother
Eko
of
Esco
and of Aner. These were allies of Abraham. When Abram heard that his kinsmen had been taken captive, he led forth his trained men, born in his house, 318 of them, and went in pursuit. And he divided his forces against them by night, he and his servants, and defeated them and pursued them to Hobah, north of Damascus. Then he brought back all the possessions and also brought back his kinsman Lot with his possessions and the woman and the people. Let us come to the Lord in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we ask that you will help us as we come to your word this morning. Please reveal your word to our hearts and Holy Spirit, teach to us what you want us to learn and give us spiritual ears so that we will hear your word. And Holy Spirit, rule through this time so that my words and our meditations together will be pleasing to you. And Lord, we pray that you will give us your power to do your will. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thưa quý vị, Chúa Giêsu đã đến để tìm
và cứu chúng ta. The Lord Jesus came to save, to seek and save us, and He has restored us. And that is the restoration ministry. Restoration ministry is a ministry that's so needed, but oftentimes it is neglected. And this is a ministry that we need to pursue, and we need to find ways to restore our brothers and sisters who are fallen in sin. And so we, if we want to avoid that, then we sometimes avoid that because of different reasons. Some we don't like to have conflicts with others.
We
don't want to oppose people or to we don't want to accuse anyone or criticize anyone. We know that we have some weaknesses in ourselves, and so we don't want to think that people think of us as hypocrites. And so we often say, that's not my job. And so just let our brothers and sisters to live in their sin.
Or
maybe we share the story of that person to the pastor or to the people in the board. And so we push it over to the pastor and the elders in the church to take care of the problem. But in Galatians 6, 1-2 says, brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ.
Linh vụ phục hồi
the
người anh chị em bị sa ngã
ministry of restoration of our brothers and sisters who are fallen. It belongs to each one of us. It is our responsibility as those who walk in the Holy Spirit. Although this may not be an easy task, but it is something that is very important for the life of the body of Christ. If we are not faithful to the Lord, if we are not daring and courageous enough to restore our brothers and sisters, and we don't accomplish this ministry to have results, then the Church of God will become not just a church, but it becomes like an organization. And so we, God gives us the responsibility that we have to help our brothers and sisters and restore them, correct them. Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Job had chosen the wrong path. Lot, not Job, but Lot. Lot has chosen to go to Sodom. Sodom is a place full of greeneries and pastures and waters. It was in Genesis 12, let's see that Lot moved and lived in the city of Sodom. Lot fell into a state of slavery. This city, Sodom, we have to say, use the word as, it's a city-state. It's a city, each city is a state in English. So just the city and the surroundings of that city is under a king. So that city of Sodom has a king. Gomorrah has a king, and other cities have, so they're a city-state, they have a king. They rule by themselves, they have their own king. And so these cities, they submitted to the kings, the eastern kings, for 12 years. But then in the 13th year, they rebelled. And so the kings of the eastern nations did not want these people to escape their hands, so they came to resolve the problem. And so in verse 1 to 7, it's a lengthy passage. These kings, they have two jobs to do. They go to these cities to the south, and then they go to the north, and they will punish these cities. And now they're to punish Sodom and Gomorrah, the place where Lot was dwelling. And in the end, they defeated Sodom. And the king of Sodom ran away, and they took the possessions in Sodom, and amongst those people was Lot that was taken prisoner. And Abraham came to help Lot. A servant escaped and went to Abraham and notified him of what happened. And so they said that the army came and took us away, and amongst them was Lot. And so through this story, we learn that we need to have love for our brothers and sisters and the faith in the Lord Jesus Christ so that we can restore our brothers and sisters to return to a better relationship with God. And the two requirements that are needed, two elements that are needed in restoration ministry is, first of all, is love, and second is we need to have faith. We need to have love and we need to have faith in order for us to participate in this ministry. First of all, is the motivation for you to be able to face the difficulties and the obstacles when we want to reach out to our brothers and sisters and help our brothers and sisters to help them escape from sin. It is love that is the motivational force to help us to lift up our fallen brothers and sisters. In Genesis 14, verse 14, when Abram heard that his kinsmen had been taken captive, he led forth his trained men, born in his house, 318 of them, and went in pursuit as far as Dan. Abram had reserved for Lot the love that Lot was not deserving of. And do you know what that love is called?
lại gọi là ân
sủng. It is called
là
grace. It is love. Love is grace. Grace is love that is
Chúa
for a person who does not deserve it. The Lord God loves us though we do not deserve to be loved. He loved because He is love and He gave us His grace.
Abraham đã dành cho Lot cái tình yêu đó,
had
cái ân sủng
that
đó.
Love for his nephew, Lot.
Lot
did not appreciate Abraham, the one who loved him, the one who nurtured him when he was little. And when the Lot's father passed away, Lot came to live with Abraham. And Abraham taught Lot how to be a shepherd and how to be a herdsman. But Lot was not in gratitude, yet he chose the land that was better for himself. But Abraham showed forth his grace to Lot. When he heard that Lot was taken captive, Abraham pursued and rescued him. The love and the grace, or the grace or the love that you have for those who are in bondage of sin. But God gives us that grace. God loves us, and we are not worthy of it. We are worthy of being punished forever. But God, Jesus Christ loved us, and He was willing to die for us so that we can live. It is by God's grace that brought salvation to us who are sinners, and we need to use the love of God, the grace of the Lord, to help those who have fallen into sin. What is grace? Grace is love reserved for those who do not deserve.
Abraham
not only gave himself, sacrificed himself to pursue after these kings for Lot. When he heard that Lot, the news that Lot was taken captive. But because Lot was Abraham's nephew and he loved his nephew, therefore he pursued these kings. Although Lot lived in Sodom, that is not a right thing to do. But Lot was still a man who feared the Lord. And Abraham and Lot was also Abraham's nephew, and Abraham
know
how to keep his kinsmen. And people
will
say, "Am I my brother's keeper?" No, but Abraham said, "I am my brother's keeper." May the Lord help each one of us to be our brother and sister's keeper. Although Lot has sinned, and now he is seeing the consequence of his wrong choice, yet Abraham pursued after the enemy to rescue Lot. If you are children of God and you are living in life, in this life, this is the picture of the consequence that we have to endure. Lot chose Sodom because he thought that he can be rich in this land. He thought that this land, this earth, can bring him satisfaction and blessings. But the enemies attacked and took away all his possessions, and he and his family became slaves. When you and your my friends, when we throw away things that we consider in bondage to the Word of God, and yet we pursue what this world has to offer, then we will be in bondage, in prison by the enjoyments that we are pursuing. Whoever sins is a slave to that sin. Sin promises us freedom, but in the end, we become slaves to sin. In 2 Peter 2:19, they promised them freedom, but they themselves are slaves of corruption. For whatever overcomes a person, to that he is enslaved. So we see the path that goes downwards of Lot. Lot went to Sodom. He went close to Sodom, and then he went into Sodom, and then he became a slave. The same, many people are like that. Not is that they just jumped into sin. No, not that they jump into adultery or jump into fornication, but they play around with it and then eventually accept it. And then in the end, they sin against God and are enslaved to that sin. When we do not live in the boundaries of God's word, then we will be enslaved to sin. If we do not live in the limitations that the Lord provides for us, then we will be in bondage to sin.
Cái điều chúng ta được học trong lời Chúa,
what we learn through God's word and through the example of Abraham is that when our brothers and sisters fall into sin, then we need to be bold to restore that brother and sister to the Lord. Because the love for God and the love for our brothers and sisters, we cannot sit still and not do nothing. Going back to Galatians 6:1-2, brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. The law of Christ is encompassed into one word. What is that? Love. One thing, that is, love your God, the Lord your God, with all your heart, soul, and strength, and love your brother as yourself. So when we fulfill the law of Christ is when we bear each other's burdens. We lift up our brothers and sisters who have fallen because of love, but we can only do that by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Oftentimes, when we don't have a relationship with the fallen, the one thing that you can do for that person is to pray for that person.
But
if you really care for the one, then the Lord wants you to intercede. Do you ever think that it is convenient or is easy for you to pursue one who lives in sin? Do you think that it's easy to rescue them from the hands of the devil? The answer, I believe, that all of us is no, it's not easy. It's very difficult for us. It is very inconvenient to intercede, to step into the life of one who is a sinner. But we want to rescue that person from the bondage of sin. It is daring and it requires a lot of effort and strength and time. But the Lord Jesus is our example. He came to seek the lost and He came to seek us. And now He wants to do that through us. He wants to live in us and He wants to use us
as
vessels lifted up to Him so that we can be used by Him. And He does it through us. By faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, to live in Him and rely on Him. This is something that is not the job of a pastor, of a shepherd, of a leader, but it's the responsibility of each believer, those who are in the Lord Jesus Christ. And through the story of Abraham rescuing Lot, we learn the method or the technique for us to rescue our brothers and sisters who are fallen, to be a slave to sin. First of all, in order to rescue our brothers and sisters, to help them, we must separate from the world. Although Abraham was separated from Sodom, yet Sodom seeked him or went after him. A person was able to escape and went to Abraham, who was a Hebrew. The Sodomites knew Abraham. He did not live near them, he did not live with them, but because of what? Because the Sodomites were very evil. Later we will see how evil these Sodomites are.
But
Abraham lived far away. He lived on a hill near the Amram
and
certain trees. Abraham lived in the world, but he did not live of the world. He separated himself from all people. We see that Abraham was one who lived with other people. He lived by the oaks of Mamre, the Amorite, brother of Eskah and of Aner. These were allies of Abraham. That is, we live with those around us. We live, but we do not separate ourselves from him. But we cannot participate in sinful living of theirs. So let us be clear that we live in this world, but we are not of this world.
Dân Sodom biết về Abraham.
The Sodomites knew Abraham.
Và khi họ gặp
and
khó khăn,
when they faced difficulty, they ran to him.
Khi gặp khó khăn, when thì họ lại có một cái quan điểm khác về ông Abraham.
They had difficulties. They had a different perspective of Abraham, and they were thinking, "Oh, Abraham is one who can save us." So he ran. They ran to Abraham as a source of hope. Christians who live a holy life is the same. They will not participate in the sinful ways of this world, the deceitful, the pleasures of this world. And the people of this world will laugh at them and criticize them. But when the people of this world face difficulties, they will seek out Christians to pray for them. Do you see that? That's amazing, right? Normally, they will put down Christians, but because they are in the hospital because of cancer or because how their children are gone astray, then they say, oh, please pray for me, pray for me. If Abraham lived in Sodom, he would probably be enslaved or be like Lot, to be a slave to that world. But no, Abraham lived by the oaks of Mamre, the Amorite, brother of Eskol and of Aner. And they were allies of Abraham. So sometimes we do work with those around us, but we are not in, together with them, like conform to them. Abraham was there and he worked there and he lived there, but he worshipped the Lord. All people knew that he was a child of God and belonged to the Lord. He did not hide his faith. He built an altar to worship the Lord at the oaks of Mamre. And the Bible is very clear. He made an altar to Jehovah God at the oaks of Mamre. There are some people who are afraid that others will know that you are children of God. And so they don't dare say anything. There was this one pastor I know in the past when he went to work. He was in Vietnam. He was an engineer. And then he went to somewhere. And for years, people not know that he was a child of God. But then after a while, God took a hold of him and he repented and he came to the Lord truly and was called by God to be a pastor, and now he's a pastor in our district of the CMA, Vietnamese CMA. Abraham was not hesitant to let others know that he was a child of God. There are some people who are afraid to let other people know that you're a child of God. And so if you live a life, you curse like other people, or you become angry, or you try to fight for your customer like others, then people will look down on your God. And so you might as well just hide and say that you're not a child of God. No, we are children of God. We're not afraid of anything. I remember one time when 1999, at that time, there wasn't much freedom in Vietnam, and I went to Vietnam, and there was a hotel, and relatives came to visit and the hotel, and when they left, I asked them to sit together and pray, and I was hesitant, because I don't know how the situation was in Vietnam, but when I invited for prayer time, my cousin prayed, and he prayed so loud, he thanked the Lord, he praised the Lord, he was not afraid of anything. And then later, I heard that they called him up to the office, but he wasn't afraid. He proclaimed that he was a child of God. And so thank the Lord for that, that Abraham publicly, though he lived in the midst of the world, yet he let everybody know that he does not belong to this world, but to God. So people knew that Abraham was a Hebrew who worshiped God. And so this is how people can separate him from the people around him. From being separated from the world, Abraham was free to rescue Lot. And so the only way for us to help our brothers and sisters who are living in sin in this world is that we separate ourselves from the world. We live in the world, but we do not live of the world. In Galatians 6:1a, brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual,
one of the reasons that the
believers of Christ are hesitant to face a sinner, one who is living in sin, is because in their life they themselves are living in sin. So if you don't pick on my sin, then I will not pick on your sin. But if we live like that, nobody can help anybody. There's someone, one time, someone came to me and said, Pastor, did you know that that man is living with that woman, and that man is a Christian? Now what must you do? And then I said, you need to go to that gentleman and say, you can't live that way. You help that person so that when you fall, that person can help you. We have responsibility to each other. We cannot accuse one another, but care for one another.
Quý vị đã vấp ngã và phạm tội cùng Chúa chăng? Hãy ăn năn, xưng tội.
If you have sinned against God, then repent. And in the name of the Lord Jesus, return to Him, leave the path that you were going, and live in a righteous life, in the life filled with the Holy Spirit. And then the Lord will help you to help your brothers and sisters. Peter had fallen into this, and Jesus foretold that you would deny me three times, but after you deny me three times, you will be restored and you will help your brothers to stand firm. It's not that Peter was perfect and did not sin. He sinned against God, but he turned around to the Lord, and God used him to become a leader in the church, to become a leader to his brothers and sisters in the church. The one who is most ashamed when Jesus resurrected was Peter. How can I face the Lord Jesus? I have denied him three times. But the Lord Jesus loved him and came and said, Peter, do you love me? And Jesus restored him so that he can become a vessel useful in the hands of God. So if you know that you have sinned, do no longer live in sin. Repent of your sins before the Lord. And the Lord is faithful. He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. There is one who gave a testimony. He sinned against God. And he said very proudly, after he came to the Lord Jesus, he came home and said to his wife, I can leave my wife, but I cannot leave my God. And the wife was so angry, threw all his belongings out of the house. And when he left the house, he met a young woman in the church, and the two lived together, and she gave birth. And then afterwards, the Lord spoke to him, convicted him of his sins, and he repented of his sins. He turned away from that life and came back to his wife. And now the two came to live here. And now he no longer hides that sin, but he boldly says, I sinned against God, and I have turned back to the Lord, and I have repented, and I have been restored by the Lord. So brothers and sisters, those who are living in sin, turn away from your sin, turn back to the Lord, and He will restore you as He has restored me. He was not proud of what He has done, but He was grateful to the Lord for restoring him, and he was willing to speak of his sin and not be ashamed of it or hide it of the evil that he has done. To what? For what? So that he can show forth the great love that God has for him, so that others who are living in sin like that will repent of their sins and come back to the Lord. Secondly, if we want to help our brothers and sisters, we need to prepare ourselves. Prepare in verse 49. Behold, this was the guilt of your sister Sodom. She and her daughters had pride. So Abraham prepared to go into battle. He had 318 who has been prepared. And Sodom was a place that was full of luxury. But people lived there in sin. And so, one of the sin of the people in Sodom is laziness. There are four sins that people often fall into: love, money,
và tà tà.
Like pride and laziness. Some people do not fall into the sin of love, adultery, fornication, greed of money, or that you are pursuing your name and fame. But there's the fourth one, which is just being lazy, just being...
In Ezekiel
16:49, says about Sodom, "Behold, this was the guilt of your sister Sodom. She and her daughters had pride, excess of food, and prosperous ease, but did not aid the poor and needy." So prosperous ease is just basically laziness, but did not aid the poor and needy. So the people of Sodom, they were not busy to find food or clothing. They had excess of food. They had excess of time, and it results in laziness. In English, it's prosperous ease. That is, they're so prosperous, they're so rich that they become lazy. And so they did not use their time to prepare for battle. They had a lot of they had a lot of things that were to their benefits. They had like some pits that they can make into like baits so that the enemy can fall into it. But their king, even their king fell into the pit. So why? Because they lived in laziness and prosperous ease.
But the laziness
is not a part of the men of Abram. Abram took 318 who were prepared and with his army went to rescue Lot. Although Abram was one who loved peace, yet he prepared for war. There's a saying that if you want to fight for peace, you must prepare for war. So in the time of peace, Abram prepared for war. He prepared his men, he equipped his men. Besides being servants, the 318 servants were trained for battle. So the same way we need to prepare for spiritual battle, we need to fight against the temptations, the evil. To be lazy and to waste time, and then to complain that you have no time to read Bible or to pray, then we are just like the Sodomites, the people who live in Sodom and Gomorrah. That during this pandemic, the Lord allows us to be home. So we need more time. The Lord allows us more time to prepare for difficult times coming, to prepare for our spiritual life, to be closer to the Lord, to know the Word of God more, to understand His Word deeper, so that we can be prepared not to waste our time for the days that the Lord has given to us, so that when we face the battle, we will be able to fight. When there is lack of preparation spiritually, and if we want to be used by the Lord to help our brothers and sisters fallen in sin, then we need to use our time each day, each moment of every day, to prepare ourselves for a spiritual battle. Paul says, "You who are spiritual brothers," he is not saying that you accomplish it in morning and night in one day, that's it. No, spiritual life is a training in process. That is, we walk step by step, little steps, baby steps, then bigger steps, and train ourselves so that we can be equipped spiritually. One who walks in the Holy Spirit is one who walks each step with the Holy Spirit. In each of our thoughts, our words, our deeds, we need to place ourselves under the rule of the Holy Spirit. That is spiritual life. Galatians reminds us that one who is a spiritual brother, one who has bared the fruit of the Holy Spirit. And that requires time. It takes time to be holy. It takes time to be holy. We need to spend time in order to be holy.
Bước đi bởi Thánh Linh
to walk in the Holy Spirit requires training, and to walk each step of the Holy Spirit, you will not grow up in the Holy Spirit and in His Word. Then you cannot use these principles to help in the spiritual battle, to help our brothers and sisters. And so we need quiet time to grow in our spiritual life so that it prepares us for spiritual battle. Do we spend time each day for the Lord? Do you spend time each day to read the Word of God and meditate on His Word and talk to the Lord to help you to walk in His Word? And thirdly, we need to, in order to help our brothers and sisters, we need to use wisdom. The wisdom that God gives to us. In verse 16, actually 15, Abram divided his forces against them by night, he and his servants, and defeated them and pursued them to Hobah, north of Damascus. Abram divided his forces into different groups to attack. The enemies were probably asleep. They had won some victories and had gained some possessions, and now their prey celebrated, and now they're tired and sleeping. And so Abraham was taking advantage of this, of the night, and he divided his forces. In the night, he only had 318 servants. That is, the enemy is so vast, but he used a technique or strategy that we see that only 318, yet he divided his forces and they yelled out and people were afraid. Abraham used this strategy probably, and so
những người phụ nữ cũng như những tài vật lại, và bây giờ Abraham đuổi theo những người đó.
And now he pursued. Abraham and his men pursued the enemy, and they were able to defeat them and rescue. So Abraham used the wisdom. He relied on the Lord to have wisdom. And we examine the way that Nathan had faced King David. When King David committed adultery and also committed murder, Nathan came and shared a story that caused David to have compassion for the person who was the victim. And in the end, David could not stand it and say, who can be so evil that would take the sheep, the lamb of the poor man? He had so many sheep and lambs, and yet he took of the poor man's lamb. And Nathan said, you, my king, are that man. And so David understood. You could have any woman to be your wife in the land, and yet you took the wife of another man. And so Nathan worked in wisdom, and David cried out in repentance. So when we have to face our brothers and sisters and confront them to help them in their sins, we need to have time with the Lord and ask God to give us wisdom. And what is the best way? What are the best words so that that person will see their sin and repent? We need to be careful. We need to prepare ourselves and ask the Lord to help us to know what to do and what to say. Pastor Howard Hendricks has shared about him coming to preach at a church. And when he came to that church, the wife of the pastor there came to pick him up from the airport or whatever. And when he came home, the wife said, I have one request. My husband works so much. He works so much that he might have a heart attack at any time. So, Pastor, while you're here, would you please tell my husband to work less and keep his health? Watch his health. And so she's told her husband many times, but the husband doesn't listen. So now she's begging this pastor or asking this pastor to help. So maybe most of us have a tendency to, when we hear this, that we will come to the pastor of the church saying, Pastor, you work too much. And then what would the pastor say? Well, this is God's work. If you don't do it, how can it be? You have to do God's work. But the Dr. Hendricks, this pastor, he didn't do that. He waited for the right time, and then he said, Pastor, do you drink any medicine? And then this pastor say, what? Why? Wondering, and he got a little upset, and he answered, of course not. And then Pastor Hendrick says, continue, why don't you drink medicine? And he said, because my body is the temple of God, so I protect the temple of God. And so Hendrick said, then why do you work so much that you don't take care of your health and you abuse the temple of God? We need to have the wisdom that God gives to us. That pastor was so, that pastor understood what the Dr. Hendrick was sharing with him. So may the Lord give us wisdom so that we can help our brothers and sisters when we help them to rescue them from the sin that they're in bondage to. And so the fourth point is that we need to act according to principle. In verse 16, says, and at the end of 7 days, the word of the Lord came to me. Then he brought back all the possessions and also brought back his kinsman Lot with his possessions and the woman and the people. After Abram rescued Lot, do you know where Lot returned to? Lot went back to Sodom. And in later, we will learn that God will save him from Sodom once again. But when he has been rescued from the bondage of slavery, where did he return? He returned right to the place where he became a slave to sin. Lot did not want to change. He did not learn any lesson from this experience. He had no words of gratitude. Though he was imprisoned and taken captive, he went back to Sodom to live in spiritual decay. So Abram did not rescue Lot to go back to the old ways, but yet Abraham rescued Lot. Have you ever heard of a follower of Christ who has fallen into sin and you wonder, why should I help him out? If I help him out of the sin, he'll still fall into that sin. You know what? There are three reasons to help that person. First of all, the love of God. Love of God compels us to do it. We cannot sit still and let that person be destroyed and be a slave to sin. We need to be involved. And the second reason is that we do not know what the future holds. And so we cannot say that your brother and sister will never fall again. We need to help them. Maybe that person will return to their sin, but at some point, the Lord will rescue him. Maybe this time, that person will learn the lesson to walk with the Lord. And thirdly, is that we need to do it to save ourselves, because the Lord gives us that responsibility, and we need to take on the responsibility that God has given to us. If not, God will require an answer from us. Ezekiel 3:16-21 says, and at the end of 7 days, the word of the Lord came to me. Son of man, I have made you a watchman for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you should give them warning from me. If I say to the wicked, you shall surely die, and you give him no warning, nor speak to warn the wicked from his wicked way in order to save his life, that wicked person shall die for his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked, and he does not turn from his wickedness or from his wicked way, he shall die for his iniquity, but you will have delivered your soul. Again, if a righteous man, a person, turns from his righteousness and commits injustice, and I lay a stumbling block before him, he shall die because you have not warned him. He shall die for his sin, and his righteous deeds that he has done shall not be remembered, but his blood I will require from you. But if you warn the righteous person not to sin, and he does not sin, he shall surely live, because he took warning, and you will have delivered your soul. The Lord told Ezekiel that if the one who is a watchman does not warn the sinner from his sins, then God will require the blood of that person from the watchman. But if the watchman warns them, then the watchman will rescue the sinner. If we see our brothers and sisters living in sin, we have the responsibility to restore that person. No matter what that person does afterwards, that is their responsibility before God. God wants us to participate in the spiritual restoration ministry. He has seek us and save us, and He wants to seek and save those who are sinners, living in sins, through us. The Lord wants us to do this because of love, and He wants us to rely on faith in the Lord Jesus Christ to accomplish this. The ministry of restoring our brothers and sisters requires that we have love and faith. We are motivated by the love of God to receive this great commission or responsibility. It's not easy. We have to have the right word and the right deeds. So we, by the faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, to rely on the Lord to guide each step. God gives us power. God gives us wisdom in our actions, in our words, to restore our brothers and sisters. We acknowledge that we don't have the ability to face our brothers and sisters and to rescue them from sin. So therefore, we need to humble ourselves, to rely on the Lord, to trust in Him, that by His strength, by His wisdom, we can restore our brothers and sisters who have fallen. So there are four things that I'd like you to remember through this lesson, through this message today. That is, through the example of Lot, we know that whoever lives in sin will be a slave to sin. If you draw close to sin and you stay in sin, then for sure you will be a slave to sin. Second is that through the example of Abram, we see that though we live in the world, we live amongst them, yet we do not be affected by the world, influenced by them, conformed to them. And thirdly, we need to use our time for the days of evil. The Lord gives us days that we can be in training. Though we are busy or not busy, the main point is that we need to take care of our spiritual life. We need to have the Word of God. We need to draw close to the Word of God so that we can fight against the devil, against the world, against ourselves. And we need to become holy so that the Lord can use us to be a vessel to rescue others from sin. And fourthly, is that we need to rely on the Lord to have the right word and the right deeds of wisdom to when we rescue our brothers and sisters from sin. Let us come to the Lord in prayer. Our Father, we thank you, Lord, for the love that you have placed in Abram, the faith that he has in you, to rely on you, to have wisdom, to have power, to know how to use his time, to know how to use methods, strategies to rescue his brothers and sisters who have fallen. Lord, we know that this task is so difficult, and that we don't enjoy doing it. But Lord, we who have been saved by you, have been rescued from you, who have become spiritual people in you, help us to have to be able to restore our brothers and sisters, to lift them up, those who have fallen, those who are weak, those who have fallen into the desires, the lust of this life, the pride of life, of greed, so that we will rescue our brothers and sisters, so that they will enjoy the abundant life in you, Lord. We need you, Lord. Help us each day. In Jesus' name we pray this. Amen.